Coming up, ladies and gentlemen, is our opening plenary, which looks at both sides of the dilemma of growth that the jury is still out on when it comes to social entrepreneurship. Scaling fast versus scaling for impact. Each approach has its strong proponents and detractors, and this is our chance to hear them all. I would like to invite on stage the moderator of this panel, Ms. Mallika Kapoor. She is responsible for CNN's coverage from India's financial capital and also for covering a wide range of news stories in South Asia. Welcome, Mallika. I would like to now invite on stage the panelists, Mr. Harold Rosen, Executive Director of Grassroots Business Fund. Harold founded IFC's Grassroots Business Initiative, which he managed until 2008, when it was restructured and spun off to become the Grassroots Business Fund. Prior to his work with GBI and GBF, Harold worked with the World Bank Group for over 30 years. Thank you. Ms. Shumita Ghosh, founder of Rangasutra. Her dream is to ensure sustainable livelihoods for artisans in India. She has been working with producer groups for the past 20 years. Mr. Ashwin Nayak, co-founder and CEO of Vatsalya. Ashwin has more than 10 years' experience in the life sciences and healthcare industry, clinical research, and genomics in oncology. I might make a correction, that's Dr. Ashwin Nayak. I would like to also invite on stage Sri T. Vijay Kumar, IAS, Joint Secretary, Ministry of Rural Development, SSGY. Sri Kumar is an IAS officer of the 1983 batch. He is presently the Joint Secretary at the Ministry of Rural Development. Prior to this, he was the CEO of a well-acclaimed statewide poverty eradication program, the Society for Elimination of Rural Poverty, or SERP, in the state of Andhra Pradesh. Our next panelist is Mr. Shankar Narayanan, Managing Director of Carlyle India. Shankar is responsible for leading growth capital investments in India. Prior to joining Carlyle, he spent 6 years at Hathway Investments in Mumbai, and during that time served as Managing Director and CEO. Our final panelist, Mr. Srikant Shastri, Chairperson of Vivaki India and Chair Social Enterprises SIG at TIE, Delhi, NCR. Mr. Shastri provides strategic leadership as India Chairperson for Vivaki, a new entity created by the Publicis Group for leadership in the digital era. I hand it over to you now, Mallika. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Hi, everyone. I'm delighted to be here with such a distinguished panel. And also, I must say, a very carefully chosen panel. And just after the movie, I think the casting has been really well done. Between all of us here, we have people who believe in scale, people who perhaps believe scale isn't everything. We have the corporate view. We have people who think we can do it without the corporate view, which can sometimes be a bit, let's face it, greedy. We have the government view. We have the non-governmental view. So I hope between all of us, we can have a really robust and engaging discussion. Let's keep it casual. Let's keep it chatty. And let's get right on with it. I want to begin with, Harold, with you. Your goal, you've said, is economic opportunity for everyone. Given the size of India, the population of India, is this achievable economic opportunity for everyone? Is it possible without scale?
Well, thanks very much, and thanks to SANCAP and to all of you for the opportunity. Clearly, as I always say, in countries much smaller and easier than India, still scale is critical. I would say there's a question of does scale get measured by how many dollars or how many people or just how much economic improvement and inclusion we cover. But the quick answer to your question is, of course, scale is very important. I say, there's a very strong argument that says that any one element taken to excess has often in the field of development led to, let's say, things going off the track. And just if I can back up for a moment to explain that the Grassroots Business Fund basically is an impact investor. We ourselves are a spinoff really from the IFC, and we have the Omidyar Network, a few governments, and about 10 private individuals. We ourselves are dealing with many of the same issues of how big should we get, how fast, and what balance between impact and doing things that are special and innovative versus just getting as big as possible because that makes us more sustainable more quickly. I think that same story is played out really at all levels of this field in a place like India. You have the big sources of funding, you have the intermediaries through which they work, you have the social enterprises that we're all trying to reach, and really at all those levels you have that same question you've asked of should we just try to make things as big as possible or should we go for quality and worry about the granular level. My own experience, having been in the pro-poor business development field for a long time, is we tend to all think in big numbers because that's how you can look at a country like India and not despair and say that there is a big job and let's put big resources and big efforts in place. I obviously agree with that, but I look at what is needed at the most granular level, really of anything, before you get to the big story. And when I say the granular level here, that has to mean the level of the social enterprise. Of course, the fellow needs capital. But he also needs at least as much, and sometimes before the capital, good capacity building, becoming something close to a sustainable business, having the kind of connections to markets, having the business climate be civilized enough that he can prosper. When we get too worried about scale too fast at any of these levels, we tend to blow past the need to make sure the individual entrepreneurs can grow. So a couple of things that I would just caution, and let's say from our own experience that I wanted to bring up, we try very hard in the Grassroots Business Fund to blend the types of capital, meaning almost everything that's socially worthy we find in a place like this needs a period of grant funding for capacity building. We have to blend that with increasing proportions of commercial but patient capital. We often have to bring in outside mentors. Blending that and adjusting it over time is so much harder than it sounds that I think we tend to sometimes swamp the field. Let me just finish the opening comment by saying we have a very good example, including playing out today in the field of microfinance. I still say, and maybe it sounds a bit counterintuitive just now, microfinance, in my view, is by far the most successful story in the history of development. Even considering recent issues here, if you think of what happened, they had practitioners involved in building the ecosystem from the beginning. They didn't get the volume of money going into the transactions too big, too fast, and there was a lot of experimentation. There was a very smart blending of soft money with increasingly commercial funds. And if there was a problem in the last year or two, and some of it including in India, I would argue that it was things went off track because things were not done well, rather than microfinance itself is flawed. It is a critical first step. I would argue a lot of the enterprises we're talking about here are beyond the reach of microfinance in terms of the size and tenors of money that they need and the other kinds of help. And that's where I think we all have the challenge of building sustainable enterprises, which in turn can reach out to many millions of people in a country the size of India. So let me just stop there.
Glad you brought up microfinance, and we will come back to that a little bit later. It is very topical and relevant in India, of course. At the moment, I wanted to bring in Shamita, somebody who for a long time resisted the idea of scale and really believed that small is beautiful. Yet, Shamita, you have decided to scale, and some people would even say you've sold out. What was your decision? What was the thinking behind your decision to scale, and was it a difficult decision to make? Why did you decide to go from a co-op to a company with scale?
Yeah. Let me just start off by saying that the reason why we were hesitant to scale in the first instance was that I personally come from a background of social work. You can call it social enterprise now, but it was solid social work. And our philosophy there very much is small is beautiful, that you try and bring about a change in the little area that you work in the little community, and that will have spin-off effects, maybe not yourself, but you know other people doing similar work. So one of the reasons for not scaling up, the hesitancy to scale up, was that I was not sold to the idea of that big is better, bigger is better. The other one was a very practical aspect that Harold brought out earlier, that to scale up successfully, to I'd like to say here that Rang Sutra, the company that I work in, is our goal is to ensure work for as many rural artisans in India as possible. Now, when you talk of rural artisans, the number is huge. I mean, it's difficult to say exactly because the census is not always correct in this. And also, artisans are not purely artisans. Some of them are farmers and artisans together. It's a mixed way of life. It's a more organic way of life. So it's not as though they're working 10 to 6 in a factory churning out beautiful products. But the reason that one of the other reasons for hesitating to scale up was that building of the capacity, the kind of training, the kind of organizing, the kind of management that would be needed. We work in rural India and very dispersed locations. All the 2,000 artisans we work with around the year are all home-based. So it's quite a challenge. So we had to get prepared on the ground, to scale up, and it took a little while doing that. And the initial part of it was simpler in the sense working with a small group because the social capital, in a way, had already been there, was already there. There was a strong a history of, experience of NGO working there, which had organized groups. But the next stage to build on what we had successively achieved in the first 3 years to scale up is taking a bit longer, but I'd like to mention here that the reason we decided to take this step is in a country like ours, is there really a choice? I mean, in the sense, if I am saying that our mission is to ensure work to rural Indian artisans, then I can't be happy satisfied by saying, okay, we'll work with 1,000, others can work with the rest. So I think that's the reason we decided to, and I don't think it's selling out, certainly not. I mean, I think that's a step much needed.
Ashwin, what was your decision making? Because you've scaled up rapidly, and I must say it's been you've scaled up successfully building your hospitals in tier 2, tier 3 towns across India. How has that worked out for you financially as well as in making a social impact? Are the two balancing out? Are you where you want it to be?
I think fundamentally, scaling up is something which is, I think, defined by three things, which both Harold and Sumita addressed. One is genetic, the genetic composition of the company itself, right? Can you handle scale? Are you created for scale? And in some ways, I believe that the organization has to choose its own battle, whether you want to be small, focus, or you want to be a large focus, that decision you have to make. But fundamentally for us, what happened was in when deciding whether we want to scale or not, the first few years we spent on survivability. We want to make sure, yeah, so